probably the last one in that series. Now, this starts a new series, and I'm going to pause here for a minute. And see if I can get to use this little pointer here. The pictures he got in the ashram in India 10 years before this were all in black and white. Now he's using color film. So that's progress of our technology from 64 to 75. So these pictures began here at that slow approach. Here we can see a power tower and a road in the foreground. He's got a video, an 8mm movie camera set up on a tripod running on automatic, filming the same scene that he's photographing with his hand camera as the ship passes and goes along. Now, if you look down here, you'll see that there's a white sandy road running along the side of a field there. And as the ship comes closer, we can see the reflection, but it doesn't show too well here, the reflection of the white sandy road down there in the undersurface of the craft at the flange. Now, that couldn't be there if it was a small model near the camera. That has to be a large model some distance from the camera in order for the angle of reflection from the road to the camera to be such that you can see it in the bottom of the ship at all. And we see that in several of the pictures. Maybe you can see it a little better in here, and you can also see the road down there. But these were points that tended to convince us that these pictures couldn't have been faked, that the pictures were real, the events were real. So we wondered what the Pleiadians were telling him, what was going on. And he said that they told him that one of their missions here and one of the purposes for being here was that our religions have lost validity over time because of mistranslations and misinterpretations, each writer putting his own spin on what they started with, and then that was spun again by somebody else. And he said that our own religions have lost their original true simplicity by about 80%, and that only about 20% has any relation to validity at all. And this is true not only of the Christian religions, but of other religions as well. So when he revealed this information, all the religions felt themselves under attack. All religions of the world, but not only religions, but the other isms, communism, socialism, democracy, all of those were bad because they've all been corrupted by men. And the Pleiadians were saying we should be getting back to basics. We should know what we believe and why we believe it. We shouldn't accept anything dogmatically. We shouldn't accept anything because we're told to believe it, because we need to know for ourselves. And until we learn to distinguish and decide for ourselves, we will not grow up. And their mission was to show us our loss and what we need to recover to get back to basics to proceed with the evolution of our society. And that's basically what the Pleiadian mission was to point out damages that we're inflicting on ourselves by environmental factors that we have accepted. We eat the wrong foods now. We don't eat pure foods anymore. We process it and we do all kinds of things to it. They said that all of these contribute to the shortness of our lifespans. And they said that Earth lifespans were designed to be over 1,000 years. And that we have shortened to less than 10% of that. It's not all deliberate and done by us, because they explained that formerly this planet was surrounded by a vapor envelope, something like we see Mars today, a thick vapor envelope, had a lot of water in it. That's when the seas were shallow marshes. We didn't have oceans at the time. We had shallow seas. And we had vegetation. It was like a big hothouse of vegetation that grew profusely. And we had the gigantic animals because of the free availability of vegetation. And that our planet moved into a cooler region of space just by a couple of degrees, but enough to begin precipitation of the vapor envelope to the surface in the mythical flood, and it raised the oceans 200 and 300 feet and produced what we have today, a water planet with about 40% or 30% of the land surface above water. But they said that when the skies cleared, you find this in the Bible too, and they saw blue skies for the first time, that we were exposed to the harsh rays from a particularly harsh sun that reduced the span of all life on the planet by 80%, 90%. All life had its lifespan reduced by 10%. Now, this is another reason why we are such an attractive point of interest to alien visitors. Often they comment that they are amazed at the extreme variety of life in all species and classes, that this is peculiar, planet is peculiar because of its extreme variety. And others have suggested that the variety comes from the shortened lifespan and the accelerated evolution because of the short lifespan. And this may be true, it may be interesting, but we're probably not going to get those lifespans back soon. Anyway, that was one of the things that they were pointing out. They are also pointing out that we need to learn a better relationship with our, what they call the creation. They do not have a personified God. They don't have a personified deity. They have a creation, and their form of religion is to work in harmony with the creation, and this takes the form of gardening, of working metals, of working minerals. We dress them into beautiful gems and stones. When we do this, we give some kind of education to those lower forms of what they call life. Everything is alive. And by working with those lower forms, we educate them in some degree. And our mission is simply to help evolve the planet. And we're not doing a very good job of it. This is a picture was taken over. This is a sanitarium here, and he was invited to bring his camera for a flight demonstration. I think there's only one of these in there, but he took 18 pictures in sequence at that time. There's another one, you can barely see it. It's up here in the cloud, so that still clearly removes that from being a model because it's in the vapor of the low cloud scud. Let me find this. Here we go, someplace here. Right there it is, anyway. All these modern technology things. Now, this is a series of pictures that are taken over. That last one was taken at Winkle Riot, a series of pictures. This one is from the series taken over Bechtel Hornli. And they arrived this time with three ships, a mothership and two drones, on the 28th of March, 1976. And they slowly moved up the valley. He had his movie camera on a tripod. He had his hand camera, the broken Olympus, which took good pictures, but he couldn't make any adjustments on it. And it came slowly up the valley, and they circled back and made another approach, and then the two drones were sent on high station. They remained up there, and the smaller craft made slow approaches in front of his camera, passing behind vegetation to show that there are trees and bushes between the camera and the craft. Here's two ships. One of the drones is now accompanying the mothership. The second one is above it, out of sight. Here is an interesting one because over here we have the third ship eclipsed by a branch from a local tree that is out of focus. So we know this is inside of 35 feet. And that ship is outside of 35 feet. And the ship is the only thing that's in focus there. Here's another one, shows the third ship approaching an eclipse position behind the branch. Those two pictures were taken in sequence, one right behind the other, as Meyer was moving around with his camera, stepping back and forth. Here's another image taken at about that time. This is a particularly clear one. Here, this is out of focus, but you see the detail on the ship is quite clearly in focus. Here's one taken there at Bechtel Hornli. And this is